Head spinning, split pea soup spewing, horror movie demons that totally take over individual beings and turn them into superhuman destructive forces that can only be controlled by holy water, frantic prayers and fasting, and a priest being thrown around the room and almost dying before finally overcoming the powerful demon. Of course, these Hollywood images stick with us, and most of us can't help but see these type of images when we read the biblical texts that deal with demon possession. However, the truth is that while I'm sure that in some cases, these types of demon possession may have played out just this way in ancient times, closer analysis of the Bible reveals some different pictures of what demon possession may have looked like back then. You see, during Jesus' time, exorcisms were very common. There were many different types of healers who would go around professing to have the gifts and abilities to exorcise these demons. Jesus was just one among many who were believed to have these gifts. However, Jesus did distinguish himself from the others because while the other healers and exorcists used incantations and various props to perform their rituals, Jesus had the power to merely speak healing into people's lives.
All right.
When comparing the miracles and healings of Jesus with other persons from the ancient world, it is clear that while others, such as the great prophets Elijah and Elisha, performed miracles, Jesus' miracles were superior. They were also superior to some of his contemporaries, like Hanina ben Dosa and Honi the Circle Drawer, who were well-known exorcists during that time. So as we look at this pericope, a question arises. If exorcisms were a common, acceptable practice during Jesus' time, why were Jesus' exorcisms singled out and accused of casting out demons in the name of Beelzebub rather than the name of God? You see, today in the 21st century, we have social sciences that have been able to diagnose mental illnesses that our ancient forebears were not privy to. Yeah. So that anyone whose behavior was abnormal in ancient times could easily be categorized as being demon-possessed. Exorcisms played a large role in Jesus' ministry. In the Gospels, there are more stories of Jesus performing exorcisms than any other specific type of healing. As Jesus continued to perform exorcisms, the local authorities began to turn against him. The scribes and the Pharisees accused Jesus of witchcraft and also accused him of being possessed by a demon. By the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, Jesus is warned that Herod wants to kill him because of these exorcisms, and Jesus responds to Herod's threats with these words, "Go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day, I finish my work." So the question is, if the exorcisms were being regularly performed by many people, including Jesus, what was so offensive about Jesus' exorcisms? In order to answer this question, we will need to examine how demoniacs were defined in first century Palestine. Rather than a total possession of a person, demoniacs, as portrayed in the Gospels, seem to be experiencing a battle of the mind, as if two or more forces were at work in the possessed person. Another criterion for being considered demon-possessed was strange and destructive behavior, sometimes self-destructive or towards others. Oftentimes, less violent behaviors, such as epileptic fits, were also categorized as demonic. Even physical impairments like extended menstrual cycles, loss of sight, speech, and hearing were grounds for declaring one to be demon-possessed. Because of so many variables, there was a desperate need for cures, which led to numerous healers performing exorcisms. So when we begin to understand that some of these misdiagnosed as demon-possessed individuals were suffering from mental illness, we can begin to see why Jesus' exorcisms began to infuriate the social elite of his day. You see, if we look at the text, we discover that no one doubted Jesus' ability to cast out demons, as the text clearly states in verse 14. But immediately, while some marveled at this miracle, others accused him of doing these things in the name of Beelzebub, which is merely a derivative of Beelzebub and other names that just mean basically the Lord of the demons. But the question remains, why? In considering the social constructs of first century Palestine, we find that while some of the privileged classes suffered from demon possession, those who suffered the most were the underclass.
Yeah.
Those who endured the cruelty of colonization at the hands of the Romans, as well as the internal oppression they suffered under the aristocratic class of Jews in Palestine. French psychiatrist Franz Fanon, in his book, The Wretched of the Earth, examines the effects of brutal colonialism. Fanon relates the account of a young Algerian man who was self-hating and self-destructive. After extensive therapy, Fanon concluded that at the root of the young man's behavior was torturous guilt at his inability to protect his people from the pain of their subjugation. Let me say that one more time. Fanon concluded that at the root of the young man's behavior was a torturous guilt at his inability to protect his people from the pain of their subjugation. Does that sound familiar, my brother and my sister? Well, let me see if I can break this down like a Project Elevator for y'all, all right? Anybody ever heard of the Willie Lynch letter? Amen. See, the Willie Lynch letter is a letter purportedly written during the early 18th century by a man named Willie Lynch to a group of slave owners, in which he lays out a comprehensive strategy teaching them how to better control their property. Now, before I go any further, let me first say that the authenticity of the contents of this letter have been disputed, due in part to some inconsistencies in terms of language, and the dispute is that some of the words in the letter were not in use during the time that this letter was written. However, no one disputes that the methods described in this letter are tactics that were used time and time again in order to break the black man and the black family. Amen? Amen. It is important that I say this because there are historians among us that will tell you this as soon as I finish this sermon, and rightly so. But the point is that sometimes even a fictional story can convey a truth in its message that a historical one may not.
Yes.
So let's get back to this letter. You see, in this letter, Mr. Lynch describes how to break both the male and the female slave. He puts it this way. Take the meanest and most restless nigger, strip him of his clothes in front of the remaining male niggers, the female and the nigger infant, tar and feather him, tie each leg to a different horse faced in opposite directions, set him on fire, and beat both horses to pull him apart from the remaining niggers. The next step is to take a bullwhip and beat the remaining nigger males to the point of death, all in front of the female and the infant. Don't kill them, but put the fear of God in him, for he can be useful for future breeding. By doing this, we have reversed nature by burning and pulling a civilized nigger apart and bullwhipping the others to the point of death, all in the female nigger's presence. By her being left alone, unprotected, with the male image destroyed, this ordeal causes her to move from her psychologically dependent state to a frozen independent state. In this frozen psychological state of independence, she will raise her male and female offspring in reversed roles. For fear of the young male's life, she will psychologically train him to be mentally weak and dependent, but physically strong. Because she has become psychologically independent, she will train her female offspring to be psychologically independent. So what have you got? You've got the nigger woman out front and the nigger man behind and scared. And he ends this by saying, this is the perfect situation for sound sleep and good economics. You see, when a people are continuously subjugated, their perception of terror becomes heightened. New Testament theologian Paul Hollenbach states this, the native is an oppressed person whose permanent dream is to become the persecutor. And this is where people become unhinged. As Pastor Brawley would put it, everything that we are, we were made in America, amen? The point here is that the colonial situation of domination and revolution nourishes mental illness in extraordinary numbers in the population. So preacher, what does this have to do with the text? Well, the point I'm trying to make is that one of the reasons Jesus' healings and exorcisms were being condemned was not because of how he was healing people, but more so of who Jesus was healing. See, one of the questions always asked about our people is, what's wrong with black people? Why can't we get it together? Maybe part of the reason has to do with the constant trauma that we have endured through centuries of oppression and colonialism. But it's also important to understand the tactics of the enemy. What is the best way to destroy those that oppose the powers that be? By demonizing them, that's how. You see, it's no different today than it was back then. Today we watch the news and we see black men called animals because of the high crime rates in the inner city. And unfortunately, some of us buy into this without ever considering how we got this way.
Yes.
But as long as black men are demonized, there's no need to. They just put us in prison to create a free labor force and then watch as news commentators decry the lack of black men at home with their families. How are we supposed to be home and locked up at the same time? Then when some of us get out, there are no jobs. So when we try to feed our families by working outside of the system, we are criminalized all over again. And if we resist the temptation to engage in criminal behavior and work within the system by trying to help rehabilitate ourselves through state-run programs, then we are demonized by the same media for being lazy takers looking for a handout. We can't win. But let's remember what Jesus' mission was. In Luke 4, 18 and 19, Jesus states the purpose of his ministry. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. You see, what is happening today is the same thing that was happening during Jesus' time. Jesus saw how those poor Galileans were being demonized by the powers that ruled over the poor and oppressed, how the priestly aristocracy was demonizing those poor peasants for not paying tithes, even though some of them couldn't even afford to because they were starving. Jesus saw how those who suffered from diseases and infirmities were ostracized from the society and not allowed to worship in the synagogues. And Jesus also saw how any citizen who spoke out against this oppression was demonized. So Jesus started healing these types of people. He started to give them back their dignity. And when Jesus starts exercising these demons and calling the real demons by their names, what do? They try to demonize him by saying that he was the one working for the devil. So how does Jesus reply to these accusations? Well, I'm glad you asked, because first Jesus shows them how ridiculous these accusations are by explaining that if he, Jesus, was casting out Satan's demons in the name of Satan, wouldn't he be weakening Satan's kingdom? Secondly, Jesus reminds them that if they are wrong, and that these healings are indeed done by the finger of God, which the Jews would have recognized as an allusion to the hand of God that delivered their forebears in Egypt in the Exodus, then they must concede that Jesus is more powerful than Satan, which would also imply that the coming kingdom that Jesus promised had now been inaugurated. It's right here in verse 22. But when one stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from him all his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils. And this is why Jesus was such a threat. When we look at this text, let us not forget that our healing is not always in everyone's best interest. As long as we are killing one another, we are not a threat to the status quo. Yeah. But when Jesus rehumanizes those who have been dehumanized, masses of voiceless people begin to cry out for justice, and the dominant culture gets nervous. When the demons of class and race are exercised, powerless people become empowered, and they demand their right to the American dream. When Jesus restores the Imago Dei in us, the prison industrial complex suffers, and the rich start losing control. Relationships become whole, and love begins to reign. Black men begin to love themselves again, and the thought of taking another brother's life becomes unthinkable. And when we as black men learn to love ourselves, our sisters become safer in our arms. Our women are no longer seeing each other as competition, but true sisters. Houses become homes, and broken homes become families. The spirit of community returns, and your children become my children again.
Yes.
Our sisters no longer feel the need to wish each other happy Father's Day anymore, because daddy's home to stay. We will no longer see each other through the eyes of our oppressor, but instead we will see one another through the eyes of God. Because when Jesus' kingdom truly comes, no earthly kingdom can compare. So black man, black woman, take a good look at one another and say, I love you, I need you, you are not my enemy. Amen. And so I leave you with the words from our Lord and Savior, who gives us these words of blessed assurance when he says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Amen. God bless you, St. Paul.